On Fremont Avenue, built by Pearl and Fred Jurfetz, has graced southern Los Altos for more than 70 years. It's now known as Villa Rosa because of the beautiful rose bushes and rose trees that grace its property. In 1994, the present owners allowed the American Cancer Society to use their home as its showcase house for its annual fundraiser. Hello, I'm Nan Geschke, your host at the Los Altos History Show. Our guests tonight are Judy and Van Fucilla, the present owners of Villa Rosa. Welcome, Judy and Van.
Thank you for having us. So nice to have you.
And we enjoyed our visit with you so much when we went out on location to shoot your beautiful home. So it's so nice
to have you. I enjoyed it too.
It's so nice. Now, I understand that you are the second owners of Villa Rosa, and even though it's 70-some years old, that's kind of unusual. And I understand you bought it through a probate sale, and that must have been kind of stressful.
Yes, it was our first house.
Right.
And it was an auction at that.
An auction?
Yes.
Oh, wow. I'm sure there were lots of people interested in it. But what do you know about the first owners, the Jurfetzes?
Well, what we've learned was from the caretakers that were still there when we bought the house, and then for the Cancer Society, history was done, and that was very, very helpful. Fred Jurfetz was born in Woodstock, Illinois, and he came to San Francisco to find his way. And he went to work for the Smith Exchange Typewriter Service, and he was a serviceman there. Mm-hmm. Their facilities were was on Sutter Street, but the earthquake in 2006 destroyed the building, and thereafter they moved to Oakland, California, and he joined them there. And sometime later, he went out on his own with sort of a franchise with Smith and Underwood.
Underwood and Remington both.
Uh-huh. Right.
They were the two big typewriter companies
yes,
at that time.
Right. Uh-huh. And a young woman joined him, Pearl Morris, and she worked the office doing the billing and taking care of customer billing.
So they were quite a team, huh?
They were quite a team, and they worked things out very well. And what was interesting was that they were married. They were married in 1913.
They worked out
yes.
so well that they decided
they
to get married.
Right. But in 1915, the Pan Pacific Exposition was held in the marina. And it was quite an exotic exhibit with many buildings besides that of the Palace of Fine Arts. The Jurfetzes had an exhibit in the Palace of Machinery.
Oh, I love that name.
That is something. And they had this giant typewriter. It was billed as the largest typewriter in the world.
I think we're bringing up that picture of a typewriter on the monitor now.
Well, that typewriter weighed some 14 tons. I mean, it was a big thing and brought in a lot of people and helped their business along quite a bit. Now, the typewriter at that time, you might compare it to our computers today. Mm-hmm. It was such a new, wonderful thing for communications. And
it would be equivalent of having the two franchises they had with Remington and Underwood would be the equivalent of having Apple and IBM franchises in.
So a distributor like Fry's might be.
Yes, right.
Uh-huh. So it was quite a successful business.
It was. They prospered very well in this business.
I remember when we were talking before the show tonight that when I was doing some research a few years ago, I saw in one of the ads from a magazine that was during the First World War that a typewriter cost over $100, which was a very expensive machine. So they probably had quite a markup on it, so they probably did quite well financially.
That's right.
But they decided, and where did they live? Did they live in San Francisco?
No, they lived in Oakland.
In Oakland. Mm-hmm. So they decided to make a change though, correct, Van?
Yes.
In the mid-20s?
They sold their business and their other holdings in the area, and we don't know why they did that. Perhaps they just wanted a more quieter life in what was a rural area at that time. We don't really know, but they came down and soon established a connection with this area. They bought 20 acres.
20 acres.
That was in an orchard. And this sort of interesting history of that. There was an area called the Emerson Tract, which was 900 acres in grain. That covered most of the area here. And eventually this area was divided into 20-acre parcels, which were considered the ideal size for an orchard.
Orchard, yes.
And they purchased one of those 20-acre tracts and then came down to work it as a working orchard, not just a hobby farm.
And walnuts and apricots.
And that was the whole area here with walnuts and apricots. But they also decided to build a residence, and didn't they?
Yes, that's there is a connection with Stanford here.
Yes.
That isn't fully defined either. But back about 1924, Herbert Hoover had decided that Stanford was losing a lot of talent, or rather, California's losing a lot of talent. So he proposed a business school for Stanford University. And he did this at a meeting up in the Bohemian Grove. And he recruited 125 people, businessmen, to support this. We believe that Fred Jorfitz was one of those 125. Certainly he had close connections with them, because when he came to build a house, he had the house was designed by a class at Stanford University, a graphic arts class, since they didn't have an architectural school at mm-hmm. that time. This class was given by Arthur Bridgman Clark, who was the father of Burge Clark, who many people in the area know
is
one of the most
prolific architects in the area. Yes.
And then Burge Clark and his father, A.B. Clark, designed the Hoover House, which has become the president's home in Stanford today. At any rate, this class, which was conducted by A.B. Clark, was in charge of designing the house, incorporating the ideas of the Jorfetzes into it. But otherwise, we're left relatively free to design it as they wished.
Isn't that interesting? I don't know if I would have had the kind of faith that the Jorfetz has had in a group of students, but it turned out so well.
Well, they did have some conditions that they really, she really wanted a lot of doors, and so the house is filled. Our bedroom has 9 double French doors in it. Every room has French doors.
So it has wonderful light. It's
right.
One of the main features that we attracted us to it.
So that must have been one of the requirements that they had.
Well, and we also have a flat deck around the bedroom, and they slept out of doors. They pushed cots out the out the closet door and slept out of doors.
Isn't that interesting? That was quite the rage in those days.
To get the air.
I know I've talked with other owners of historic homes, and they talk about, you know, these sleeping porches.
Sleeping porches, exactly.
Right, it's interesting. So anyway, on this, I understand that this 20-acre parcel that the Jorfetz has purchased and had this working orchard has been subdivided, and that there were other buildings on the property.
Our property is residual 2 acres of the 20-acre parcel. It went over towards Oak School, and all the surrounding houses mm-hmm. are built on the subdivided property. There were two structures, one of which remains. One was a barn of old redwood, which I wish I had preserved the redwood.
Oh.
but it was a hazard. The barn was a hazard, so we tore it down. We do keep there's a tractor shed that we use for storage now.
Well, and the garage is a major building.
And yes, we have the garage. We actually garage apartment, so we have a large garage with a workshop area, and then the three bedroom apartment above.
Yes.
Two of the bedrooms were added probably in the 1950s to encourage the caretaker to stay as he
had children.
Was having children, and they needed more space, either that or lose the caretaker.
Right. Well, you know, you mentioned that the Jorfetz is really were not hobby farmers. They really worked this as a business, but they were very interested in horticulture, weren't they? I know we're going to see that beautiful orange tree.
Is that orange tree? He was trying to develop a type of navel orange which would be resistant to cold, so that we could grow in this area. The tree in front of our house is very successful. We enjoy the oranges from mm-hmm. that each year. But he also planted pears and peaches.
Apricots.
Well, the apricots were the mainstay.
Was the crop, but yeah. The other
apricots, all sorts of different trees.
And for home use.
For home use. Yes,
right. And she was quite a gardener herself, and her prize, she had roses, but irises were her favorite flower. And
so did you find any of these plantings?
A few, and we do have a mystery. There was a pool and rock garden, and we've never been able to find out the source of the water for that.
Wow.
But there were artesian wells that supplied the orchard, and it probably was one of those that was used for it.
Well, neat. Well, believe it or not, we've run out of time for our studio interview, but we have lots more to look forward to in seeing your lovely home, Judy and Van. I want to thank you so much for joining us in the studio tonight, but I want the viewers to stay tuned for our roll-in interview with Judy and Van, so that you can see the outside of their home as well as some of the interior rooms. So let's roll that tape now. We're here with Judy and Van in front of Villa Rosa. It's a beautiful October morning, and thank you so much for inviting us to your home. We really appreciate it. I've been an admirer of this home for a long time since we've lived in the neighborhood. We used to live in the neighborhood, and I used to go by a lot and wonder who lived here. Now I know, and thrilled to be able to see it. Now, I know you have kind of a cute story, too, about how you actually saw the home and bought it.
We discovered the home also by driving back and forth. We lived in Sunnyvale, and I was a radiologist at Del Camino Hospital, and we had one car, and so that we would travel back and forth to the hospital every day with the children in tow. And that's when we discovered the house, too.
I know. Well, it's really a beautiful house. I thought maybe we could discuss some of the architectural features of the house. How would you describe the home, Van?
Well, I'm a little uncertain of exactly how to describe it. It has been called American Gothic. I'm not quite sure what that means. I personally have always thought of it in terms of being Mediterranean, somewhat like an Italian villa.
Right.
It isn't any single pure style, so that it's hard to categorize it. Although it is unusual for this area because there were so few homes dating from the time this was built, that
it is unusual for this area because of that. There are homes up towards San Mateo that we've seen that are very similar, have many of the similar details, the arched windows and doors. Although this is considerably larger than the ones that we've run across.
Yeah. Well, it has so many decorative details, which is something I've not noticed on some of the Italian villas, but it's, could you just point them out for us?
Well, we're particularly fond of the arched windows. The railings have the decorative tracery in them. They have the blind arcade, the pattern underneath the railing.
And those are all set into the facade. They're not applied to it.
No, they think they were cast at the time the walls were done.
Oh, okay. And that beautiful cabling over the windows is really, really so pretty.
So they have, there are many decorative features. I think much of this came out of the fact that it was designed in a class at Stanford under A.B. Clark, who was Burge Clark's father.
That's what we understood. And I noticed that there are two sort of insignia plaques on either side of the front entryway. Is there any significance to that, do you think, or was it just another decorative feature?
I think they're just decorative features. I know of no significance to the family that lived here and we haven't been able to turn up any others.
And these urns too, are they all original or did you add those?
No, these were on the house as it was originally shown. We have pictures of the house back when it was just being completed, and most of the urns are present in that picture.
I think we have that picture we can show our viewers too. Well, this is just a beautiful setting, and I noticed your wonderful rose that you have trained up on the side of the home too. It just really sort of adds to the name, I guess.
Well, that and the fact my wife has always loved roses and takes every opportunity she can to put them in.
Now, I thought maybe we could just step back and because I know there's this wonderful orange tree that is original, isn't it, Van?
Yes, the original owner, Mr. Jorfitz, was interested in oranges. He was trying to develop a type of orange tree that was resistant to cold, since this is not a good orange tree area. As you can see, the oranges are just beginning to turn orange now. They'll be ripe in about end of January. They're really very good, too, very good navel oranges.
Uh-huh. It looks so healthy. I don't believe I've ever seen an orange tree that's been quite that large. I mean, maybe down in Southern California, but not in this area.
It's done well. Yeah. Occasionally we've had people that have cut back some of the branches that we really didn't want cut. Most orange trees will come down lower on the ground than this.
And some of these other trees, Deodara there in front of the home. Now you said there's a little history to that tree.
These are some of the largest trees in town, if not the largest. When we first moved here, before the trees in the neighborhood grew up, we could see the tree from the distance, from the school and other areas, and we could tell people where our house was by the tree.
That's not so true anymore.
No, not anymore.
Yeah, I know, with all the vegetation that's going up. In this area. Well, I guess now it's time to go inside. So, Judy, would you lead the way?
Well, we certainly will.
We're in the lovely entryway of Van and Judy's home. It's just lovely, Judy. It's so warm and welcoming.
Well, thank you, Nan. And I agree. That's the way I felt as soon as I came into the house, that with the light woodwork in each of the rooms down here and the flooring, and all the windows, it is a very bright and happy space.
And it looks like it's a very balanced house. Is it?
Yes, it's true. The house is set up architecturally in an asymmetrical pattern with two rooms on the side, a living room and a library, and then to the side, the dining room and morning room or breakfast room, and then
two bedrooms coming up off the wings in the back.
So it's very symmetrical.
It is. And the outside, you notice that too.
Now I notice this wonderful staircase. Looks like it probably has been well used, correct?
It certainly has. And actually, I was really pleased to have, I always wanted a two-story house coming from the Midwest, Victorian house. And so I like the upstairs of the privacy of going up there and having a separate space. And we use the staircase for family photographs that all of us lined up, and
it's perfect for that.
And teaching grandchildren to go up and down stairs.
And it has the lovely ironwork too, which was very prevalent in the 20s, wasn't
it? Yes, ironwork was very important at that time.
Yeah, and you can see it in, for example, this this fixture. Is that original?
Yes, it is. And in the living room, there are companion kind of fixtures, wall fixtures, and in the library. And another feature that it was pretty popular are the niches. This niche down here, and then another one upstairs.
That's lovely. I love your bouquet that you have in front of it too. It's really kind of calls attention to it. It's
Thank
very,
you.
Very nice. Thank you, Judy. We're now inside of Villa Rosa with Judy, and this room I know is one of my favorites, and I know it's special to you. And why is that?
Well, this is where we all gather together. We have six daughters and their husbands or significant others, and six grandsons and a granddaughter. And with that number, there's a birthday or Thanksgiving or Easter.
Lots of celebrations.
At least once a month. And all our children live within an hour and 15 minutes of here. So we all gather here, and this table expands to 14 feet. So we can all fit around it. And I love to cook, and we all love to get together. And it's a nice, bright room.
It is. And I notice the beautiful carved curved door and palladium windows. You know, which add a lot of light into the room. It's just very cheerful, and I love the way you have it decorated. I noticed the light fixture over the table, and I know you have a wonderful story about that light fixture.
Well, it looks like it could be an original to the house, but it isn't. And it was my mother and my grandmother and I, we lived outside of Chicago, and in a bad part of Chicago that was at that time Halsted Street. My mother had an errand. She wanted to buy an antique cuspidor. When we went down to get it, this chandelier was sitting out on the sidewalk, and they were going to sell it just to melt it down.
Oh,
and
no.
At the time, Van was in medical school, and we were living in a basement apartment with, you know, ceilings this high with pipes and so forth. And so why did I need a chandelier like this? But I loved it. And my grandmother was with us, and she said, Judy, your birthday's coming up, and so I'll get that for you for your birthday. And so we were about 7 years in the basement apartment, and then we came to California and went to a California home that had low ceilings and couldn't use it until we moved here, and it's perfect.
It found its home.
It did.
We're in the library, I guess, now. Is that correct, Van?
Yes, that's what we call this.
And we just had this wonderful view of the archway that goes through your entire house. That's quite dramatic.
Yes, we love that view. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. And this fire of mantelpieces is interesting. What can you tell us about that?
Well, it's a little unusual in the fact that it's the reverse. There is no mantle, there's a projection. I've been told that this is characteristic of the way that Burj Kark designed his mantles, or his fireplaces in the Palo Alto homes they did. And of course, this building was designed by A.B. Kark's class at Stanford, so that perhaps this influence shows through, and also the fact that I believe these are batch elder tiles in the floor there, which is also characteristic of Birch Clark's work.
Oh, is that correct? It's interesting that this home it has so much character since it was designed by more or less a committee of people, and usually committees tend to, you know, sort of wash out character, but this has so much.
I think that A.B. Clark was probably a very strong personality. He did design the Hoover House, the Stanford, the President's House, and other things like that. I'm sure he wouldn't let the class run away.
Right. And is this light fixture original, do you think, believe?
Yes, this is original. There's only, the only piece of furniture, if you want to call it that, are the andirons and screen. Those are the only two things that came to us with the house. Otherwise, the furnishings are all ours.
Oh, well, that's very lovely. Thanks, Van. Judy, we're up here in your beautiful bedroom. This must be quite a retreat for you.
It is. I really, coming from the Midwest, we lived in two-story homes, and I was used to coming upstairs to more quiet, and we really have enjoyed that aspect.
With six children, I imagine you needed this retreat.
Right. Well, when we came, there weren't any two-story houses. Brown and Kaufman had just started building them, but this house being so old was really a find.
Right. Now, where are we in relation to the rest of the house? I know we're on the second level,
yes,
of course, but
this bedroom sits on top of the lower level, right in front. We're right above the front door.
Oh, okay.
And from the outside, you see these nine French door windows, double French door windows, one of which is covered up by the screen, which brings the outside right into our bedroom with birds chirping and so forth.
And there's patios on each side, too.
Yes.
Do you use those?
Yes, around here. We do have some hydroponic beds out there for flowers and for tomatoes. The tomatoes do especially well.
So you brought your flower garden with you up to your
that's
retreat.
That's the truth. That's right.
Well, we want to thank you and Van so much for inviting us here to share your home with us and to our viewers. I really am very appreciative, and I want to thank you, the viewers, too, for watching the Los Altos History Show. I hope you join us the next time.